of the message this morning is elect and salvation. Elect and salvation. The texts have been read. We take part of those texts from Genesis chapter 12, 1 to 6, John chapter 5, John chapter 6, John chapter 9, Romans 11, 1 to 18, Psalm 105, Hebrews 8, 8 to 13, I'm going to read it now, and Matthew 10, 4 to 8, Hebrews 8 to 13. Let's quickly go to Hebrews 8 to 13. Because finding fault with them, he says, behold, the days are coming, says Yahweh, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they did not continue in my covenant, and I disregarded them, says Yahweh. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says Yahweh. I will put my laws in their mind and write them on their hearts, and I will be their Yah, and they shall be my people. 11. None of them shall teach his neighbor, and none his brother, saying, know Yahweh, for all shall know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them. 12. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness and their sins, and their lawless deeds will I remember no more. In that, he says, a new covenant, he has made the first obsolete. Now, what is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish away. Elect and salvation. Now, one will ask, when we talk about elect, who are they? Who is the elect? Who can you say elect is? Who can you say elect is? How is the elect called? How is the elect called? Number three query there, how does the elect receive salvation? The elect, how does he or she receive salvation? Number four question, did Yahweh elect only Israel? Right, let's examine these one after the other. Let's see how far we can go to respond to elect and salvation, and the question that comes out of it. Who is the elect? How is the elect called? How does the elect receive their salvation? And did Yahweh elect only a particular people? In this case, Israel. Now, if we flashback, we have to make kind of a draw references from the text we had read earlier. If we go back to Genesis chapter 12, let's listen to Yahweh. Now, through the passages, you will deduce what this question is all about and exactly what the answer is. You will draw the answer from the responses, the passages we give to us. So I may not, you know, belaboring myself so much trying to explain, but as much as possible, pay attention. Bible is going to declare the answers to us. Bible is going to give us, the word of Yahweh is going to provide us who the elect is and their salvation. So who is elect? That is what we are treating now. The question number one. Who is the elect? Now let's go to Genesis chapter 12 and draw the answer from there. Now Yahweh had said to Abraham, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Did you hear that? In Abraham, and through Abraham, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Yahweh has positioned a man. In this case, Abraham. He has positioned him. He has chosen him. Because he told him, leave wherever you are dwelling. In your own country. Leave your own country. And I will show you. I will give you another country. Another land. Another kingdom. Where you are going to dwell, where I'm going to begin to prepare you for a call. Verse 4. So Abraham departed as Yahweh has spoken to him, and Lot went with him. And Abraham was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Then Abraham took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people whom they had acquired in Haran, and they departed to go to the land of Canaan. So they came to the land of Canaan. Abraham passed through the land to the place of Shechem, as far as the terebinth tree of Moreh, and the Canaanites were then in the land. Verse 7. Then Yah appeared to Abraham and said, to your descendants I will give this land. And there he built an altar to Yahweh, who had appeared to him. So Yahweh has made a promise. Yahweh said to Abraham, leave your land, leave where you are born, go to where I'm going to send you, land of Canaan. In that land, I'm going to bless you. In that land, you are going to bear children. He called them his descendants. And to his descendants, he is going to give that land. He's going to give that land to the descendants of Abraham. So what is Yahweh stating here? Or what did he say or state here? Now, let's take that to Genesis chapter 17. Put them together. Let's put them together to see what Yahweh is trying to tell Abraham. Now, go to Genesis chapter 17. Genesis 17. And when Abraham was 90 years old and 9, I'm reading from verse 1. Yahweh appeared to Abraham and said unto him, I am the Almighty Yah, walk before me and be ye perfect. Be ye perfect. So the only way Abraham will qualify to belong to Yahweh, to be a choice of Yahweh, to be called, to be selected, to be an elect of Yahweh, is for Abraham to be perfect. Abraham, you must be perfect. Abraham, you must be holy. Abraham, you must be righteous. Abraham, you must be pure. You must be clean. Abraham, you must not be like your people where you are coming from. Where you are coming from is full of pollution. It's full of idols. It's full of evil. Full of wickedness. Now get ready, cleanse yourself from your head to your toe. Wash yourself, purify yourself. Look unto me, watch me, hear my word, follow my instructions, be like me. There and then you will be clean. You will be pure. You will be holy. That is how I'm going to accept you and your descendants. Verse 2. I will make my covenant between me and you, and I will multiply you exceedingly. So Yahweh is not done. Yahweh said to him, whatever I said to you is going to culminate into covenant. I'm going to put our discussion, I'm going to put our agreement, our relationship is going to be binded by covenant. Verse 4. As for me, behold, my covenant is with you. That is what Yahweh has, you know, assured Abraham of. Abraham, my covenant is already, as I'm speaking to you, is with you. And you shall be a father of many nations. At this time, Abraham was 75 years old. He never had any child. But Yahweh had foreseen. Yahweh had told him in advance, not only have I chosen you, not only have you had children, descendants, these your descendants are going to be many. They are going to, you know, be part and parcel of the entire world. And you is going to be the father of nations. Verse 7, and I will establish my covenant between me and you and your seed after you in their generations for an everlasting covenant to be yeah unto you and to your seed after you. Yahweh now has said to Abraham, not only will I make a covenant between I and you, I am going to give you a special gift. Now he's been talking about giving him children, giving him descendants. But in this descendant he's going to give him, he mentioned seed. He didn't say seeds. Seed, a singular fruit, a singular person will come out of his loins, out of Abraham, and he and him alone. Yahweh now we use as instruments to generate righteousness, holiness in the family of Abraham that will bring cleansing. He will at the end bring his people into holiness, because Yahweh pointed to Abraham. That Abraham, there is something that I require of you, perfection. If you are not perfect, if your descendants are not perfect, you will not be mine. But if you are perfect and your descendants are perfect, then you are my chosen people. And this is the key. Yahweh saw in Abraham that by Abraham alone, and his descendants, they will not meet that requirement of perfection. So Abraham needed one that will do the work in his loins that come from him. Human being that will come through his generation, that will come through him. So that was a very, very strong promise. Promise that was given to Abraham many, many years before Abraham even begin to have this extended family through the offspring, generation after generation. Now let's look at verse 8. It said, and I will give unto you and unto your seed after you the land wherein you are a stranger. I'm going to give you a land. The land that Yahweh called Abraham into, Yahweh says, I am going to give you that land. Now, that land will at the end metamorphose into kingdom. That land, Yahweh spoke to Abraham in advance, something that will be coming in future. Yahweh sees the end before we talk of the beginning. As he called in Abraham into that land, he began to instruct Abraham what will happen to Abraham. How Abraham, not will he bless Abraham, but he will increase, multiply Abraham to such extent that the whole world will be the constituent of Abraham. The whole world will be the land of Abraham, so to speak. The entire world. Continuing in verse 8, all the land of Canaan he will give him for all everlasting possession, and I will be their Yahweh. So the land he promised him, he says to Abraham, you are going to possess it forever and ever. Look at when that promise was made. Before Israelites went to Egypt, that promise was made to their fathers. I mean, to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, because Yahweh continued from Abraham to his son Isaac, from Isaac to Jacob, who became Israel, who bare the 12 children that became the 12 tribes of Israel, who went into Egypt. From Egypt, he brought them back and he placed them in that land. They began to possess it gradually. Unfortunately, sin didn't allow them. That which Yahweh foresaw, Abraham, you must be perfect. The children were not perfect. So something has to be done before they take that land. No man can possess that land in the eyes of Yahweh. As Yahweh will, that land must be taken by Abraham in cleanness, in purity, in holiness, in righteousness, because that land must be clean. It's a clean land, it's a pure land, it's a holy land. Ask me, is Israel possessing that land as we speak now? No, because the sons, the descendants were not ready, they were not perfect. As even later Abraham became perfect, the children were not perfect. Up to today, Yahweh is still calling them for perfection. Yahweh is still calling them for perfection. So what did he do? Because they were messing the land. They were not allowing even the land to receive its holiness. They were tilling on the Sabbath day. If you cultivate, if you work on the Sabbath day, the land will surely be polluted. And that alone can cause Yahweh to sweep away the land, to cleanse everything that is inside it. So you have to check them out. You go and meet the Gentile wars that behave the way you are behaving. Go until after you have enjoyed them and they enjoy you. You will now know who is calling you, because Yahweh is magnanimous. Yahweh is lovely. Yahweh is gracious. Yahweh is kind. Yahweh is full of mercy. But you don't want to, you know, take Yahweh as Yahweh is. So go and enjoy the Gentiles that are going to chastise you, they are going to be your enemies, they are going to fight you, they are going to take what belongs to you, they are going to take your children, they are going to kill you, they are going to kill your children. By the time they will have done with you, you will now choose who to follow, who to serve, whether it's the Gentile and their idols or Yahweh himself. And then you will choose to come and possess the land. So Yahweh is still working out the promise, because this promise has been made, because this promise, once Yahweh speaks, it sticks. Once Yahweh say a thing, he is bound to carry it out. So he never discarded Israel, he never threw Israel away, said Israel he will not return. Israel is still the possession of Yahweh. So here we are establishing that Israel is the elect. That is what the passage is telling us. Through Abraham, they called. The descendants of Abraham You have been called. You are going to inherit the land. You are going to possess the land, not just once, not just momentarily, but for everlasting possession. That's what he told them in that verse 8. Verse 10. This is my covenant which you shall keep. So for Israel to be righteous, for Israel to be holy, for Israel to be perfect, and for Israel to possess the land, it has to go into agreement, into covenant. Because Yahweh is looking for those who will worship him in spirit and in truth. Yahweh is seeking men and women who will worship him as he is, as a holy father. Yahweh is seeking men who are honest, who are sincere to themselves, and who will be sincere to him. That is the identity of those who will inherit the land. So, this is my covenant which you shall keep between me and you, and your seed after you. Seed, singular again, not plural. Seed, as Yahweh was talking to Abraham, and also speaking to the descendants, Yahweh's eyes was on that particular seed. Because this seed is going to do the wonders. This seed is going to bring the deliverance to them. This seed is going to bring salvation. Because let the children alone, they are not going to be there. They need a deliverer. They need a savior. They need a helper. They need one to lead them. They need one to guide them into Yahweh's righteousness, or else he will wipe them out completely. Every man child among you shall be circumcised. So the commission of Abraham to possess the land is within what Yahweh calls circumcision. Circumcision is a mark or a token that showcases obedience. You must obey me. You must follow after my way of righteousness. You must be perfect. Okay, Yahweh said, I commission you into this by getting you to circumcise yourself. The stamp of this commission will be within your foreskin. He called it circumcision. That is how circumcision came about. Circumcision is not a ritual or any kind of, religious ceremony that Abraham must be observing as a law, as a law, as a law. No. It is identity. It is a token that showcases who he is. That anytime Yahweh look at him and the mark he's carrying, he said, you are bearing the mark of righteousness, mark of perfection, mark of holiness, mark of submitting to Yahweh, mark of obedience. That is what it's all about. Because the seed also is going to train them and brush them and clean them by dealing with their heart, the stony heart, because that is where iniquity, sin, defilement, everything that corrupts comes from the heart. So the seed is the one, because the seed is going to be pure and perfect without blemish. That's why the eyes of Yahweh was on the seed. In the midst of all the children of Abraham, that seed is exceptional. That seed is exemplary. That seed is going to show others the way to live a righteous life, a holy life, a life without iniquity, without sin. Verse 11, and you shall circumcise the flesh of your foreskin, and it shall be a token, a sign, a mark of the covenant between me and you. Verse 19, and Yahweh said, Sarah, your wife shall bear you a son indeed. At this time, Sarah never had the child, but Yahweh has seen the child already. Yahweh had ordained the child already, but the child was yet to come. And you shall call his name Isaac. This is the beginning of the descendants of Abraham. This is the beginning of the seed or children that will come from Abraham. Began with Isaac. And I will establish my covenant with him, that is Isaac, for an everlasting covenant, and with his seed after him. So in Isaac, as the son, the first son of Abraham, will come a seed also from that lineage, from that loins of Abraham. Abraham, Isaac. And when Isaac will beget a son again, Yahweh will make the same promise. He continues to go with that promise, continues to go with that promise, on and on and on and on, until the seed that he was looking at came in their midst, in the family. And that seed is the Messiah. Is Yahshua Messiah that finally came, passing through the lineage of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, down to David, until he came on board and became the very seed. He became the very Savior that Yahweh was looking at, that will come in their midst. Genesis 38, 10 to 15. We are like tracing how this promise that was made to Abraham. Abraham appointed, Abraham chosen, Abraham elected. How Abraham's election, you know, metamorphosed into selecting people, choosing people, electing people who will belong to Yahweh, that will have his salvation, that will possess that land. Genesis chapter 28, 10 to 15. Genesis 28, 10 to 15. Now Jacob went out from Beersheba and went towards Haran. So Jacob, at this stage, was born in the same family of Abraham. Abraham gave birth to Isaac. Isaac gave birth to Jacob, who later was called Israel. So Yahweh is giving narration of Jacob, whom he later called Israel. So he came to a certain place, that is Jacob, and stayed there all night, because the sun had set. And he took one of his stones of that place and put it at his head, and he lay down in that place to sleep. Then he dreamed, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth, and its top reached to heaven. And there the angels of Yahweh were ascending and descending on it. And behold, Yahweh stood above it and said, I am the Almighty Yahweh. I am the Almighty Yah of Abraham, your father, and Yah of Isaac. The land on which you live, which you lie, I will give to you and your descendants. The same promise Yahweh made to Abraham, the same promise Yahweh made to Isaac, is the same promise we are seeing here made to Jacob. The same promise. Also, your descendants shall be as the dust of the earth. They are going to be numerous. They are going to be plenty. Many, many of them. You shall spread abroad to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south, and in you and in all your seed, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. The same promise to Abraham. You are going to be a father of nations. Out of you, your descendants, who are going to be like dust, they will fill the earth. They will spread to the east, to the west, to the north, to the south. you can see that when Yahweh exiled them, when Yahweh scattered them, he was fulfilling his promise. He was fulfilling his promise to Abraham. But that is just the beginning. That is just the beginning of the children of Abraham scattering all over the world, getting foothold of the earth. This nourishment will continue. This blending will continue. This cleansing will continue until the entire earth produce families that Yahweh is looking at. How would that be done? The children of Abraham are scattered all over the world today. Wherever they are, in one way or the other, they are whispering to their neighbor, they are whispering to those that they live with, they are whispering to whoever that will hear them, I'm an Israelite. I'm an Israelite. I'm a covenant keeper. I'm a Yahweh follower. I'm seed of Abraham, seed of Yahweh. They are testifying who they are. Anybody that will hear them and hear their testimonies and understand what the only creator of heaven and earth has promised mankind will join them, will be grafted. Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 11 says he's grafting. They'll be grafted into the family of Yahweh, to those that believe. And when the seed Yahshua came, he told them, he gave them the same message. He asked them, go ye into the lost house of Israel, quite all right. Declare the good news. Declare the name of the Father. Declare the good news of the kingdom, of the land. Declare to the Israelites that are lost, that are scattered all over the world. Then, by extension, go into the Gentiles and speak to them in the same language. Whosoever that will believe and listen to you and believe in the name of the seed, the Messiah, Yahshua, baptize the person, that is, bring them in baptism. This is the second baptism. The first circumcision, or the circumcision of the foreskin, was the first baptism. The second baptism is the baptism that rests in the arm of the seed, Yahshua Messiah, who baptized us by, you know, dealing with the heart, cleansing the heart, purifying the heart. By the time we go into the water, immerse ourselves, and we are raised from the water, we are brought out from the water, his spirit enters and begins to do the cleansing, begins to do the purging, begins to settle us to who we ought to be. That is the second circumcision, if you like, the second baptism, if you like. So that rests in the hands of Yahshua. The second baptism, or the second circumcision, rests in the arm of Yahshua himself. No one is qualified, because anybody who is not clean cannot provide that. That is only found in Yahshua. And why that is important is that when Yahshua fulfilled all the words of the Father, he did all of them, he obeyed the Father. Now, he volunteered to die for his brethren that were carrying a curse. Anybody that will break the covenant commandment, anybody that will break the law, curse was placed on him. Curse of death, second death, that will lead to damnation forever and ever. Now, anybody that will believe in Yahshua will be brought out of that curse, will be brought out and will be placed in the kingdom. That means the person will now possess salvation. The person will be given the salvation of Yahweh. So that was obtained by Yahshua, who began to be the spokesperson of Israel. Matthew chapter 1 verse 21, this says that he will be born in the family of Joseph and Mary, and there and then he will, you know, take care of the sins of his brothers. He will forgive their sins, cleanse them, and he will show them the way. back to the kingdom. Nobody, before Yahshua came, all Israelites had wandered away from the truth. They've wandered away from the covenant that Yahweh made with Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, even the covenant he made with them in the wilderness when they were returning from Egypt. By the time the seed came, they had wandered away from it. If you look at John chapter 7, during the Feast of Tabernacle, he was chastising the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Said, you want to kill me. You said you are of Abraham, the seed of Abraham. Yet you do not do what the Abraham did. You do not keep the covenant commandment that was given to you by Moses. What was he saying? You want to kill me. You want to murder me. You are breaking the law by thinking to kill, to murder. You are breaking the law. If you are of Abraham, if you are following the covenant that Moses gave to you, you wouldn't think of killing me. Why do you want to kill me? That went on from chapter 7 to chapter 8 in the book of John. They continue to deny. Did they kill him? They did. They did. If I and you were to be in his shoes, what will happen? If I and you were to be in the shoes of the Father, what will happen? He wipe away Israel. Just kill Adam away. You are not. I thought you'd be the choice or my elect. You are not qualified. One of the key commandments, you break it to the point of killing the son. Why did you destroy the seed that will save you? The seed that will give you the land, that will give you the kingdom. You killed him. You know, Israelites did terrible things. Terrible, terrible, terrible things. To the point, it's like somebody who is incarcerated in a ditch. There's no way he will come out. And he sees somebody who will help him. And the person stretches his hand to lift him up. And he look at his face and say, look at you, you are a blind person. He starts abusing him for no just cause. What do you think the person will do? He will let his hand go, and the guy will just jump go back into the pit. But Yeshua didn't do that. The Father didn't do that. That shows the love. That shows the massive love we have in the Father and the Son. The love that I and you don't possess. But he said we must be perfect. You must possess this love. How will you possess it? How will you possess it? The chosen, Israel, the seed. Now we must be like that seed. We must be like the seed that the eyes of the Father is upon. We must be like that seed. If we are not like that seed, we can't possess the attribute, the characteristics. We can't possess it. Because without these characteristics, there is nothing we can do. We can't make it. And the characteristics is in his spirit, the Holy Spirit. The Ruach is the possessor of the character. The Ruach is the possessor of the fruit that gives us the upliftment, the cleansing, that does the surgery. It's only in the spirit. So, if you are the type that hears and tread on what you hear on the ground, you go nowhere. You will not belong. You will not be part of Abrahamic family. The salvation will elude the person, and the person will miss the kingdom. When Yahshua came, his ministry was run on two cardinal areas: the kingdom and forgiving of sins. He preached the kingdom, and he preached that we should do away with the sins. Mark chapter 1 verse 14 and 15 showcase his ministry. The kingdom is near thee. What kingdom is near thee? The kingdom in Canaan. So Abraham, leave your father's house. Leave Mesopotamia. Leave Babylon. Come to the land of Canaan. In that land, I will remove those who are there. It's no longer going to be land of Canaan. It's going to be land of Israel. That land still stands. And that land is the kingdom that Yahshua is looking at to come and possess for Israel. That kingdom is the promised kingdom that Israelites must possess in order for them to be saved. Verse 14. Also, your descendants shall be as the dust of the earth. You shall spread abroad to the west, to the east, to the north, and to the south. And in you and in your seed, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go. Jacob, wherever you go, I will keep you. Brethren, Israelites are not in that land of Canaan. Or Israel. They're not there as we speak. They are scattered all over the world. They are in the east, they are in the west, they are in the north, they are in the south. Now, what is happening is his eyes is on them. Don't ever think, oh, maybe I'm a Gentile. But a Gentile now that have been grafted into the family of Israel, then yeah, the eyes of Yahweh is on you. If you are grafted, if you are an Israelite, yeah, the eyes of Yahweh 24 hours is on you. And that is the reason you must not do anything silly. That is the reason that you must not tread with sin, iniquity, wickedness, evil. You must not break the covenant because the eyes of Yahweh is on you as the eyes of Yahweh was on Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob down to Yahshua. The eyes of Yahweh 24 hours is watching us wherever we are. Look at what he told Jacob, who became Israel. Behold, I am with you. With you. Did you hear that? Yahweh said a word, and what he says is him. His word is him. He is his word. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go. At times we think we are on our own or we alone. Do you know how many angels that encamp around the children of Israel, wherever they are, the elect? Do you know? Maybe you don't know. If you want to know, read the book of Enoch. Google the book of Enoch. Read it. Stop being lazy. Read. Massively, read. Yahweh appoints his angels. You know, there were these angels that Yahweh appointed. One third of them were taking charge of the earth before, inclusive of the adversary, Satan, Lucifer. Now, he turned the heart of those angels to himself. He made himself as the perfect man, as the righteous man, as the wonder man, that all the angels will believe in him and bow to him and follow him. And he resolved to go and unseat Yahweh in heaven. Unfortunately, he was defeated. And he was blocked from heaven. So when they fell, do you think Yahweh left mankind just like that? No. All those fallen angels will have swept them away. Look at the book of Genesis chapter 6. Because most of all those angels, we are working terrible things against humanity. And they made the first world to fall. Flood. In anger. Yahweh used flood to, because they spread sin as if sin was the order of the day. They spread sin, tutored the world sin, nurtured the world in the sin, and made the world wander away. Mankind. That began even with Adam. And at the end of the day, mankind, we are wired away from the truth. And mankind followed Satan. Up to today we speak, up to today. But Yahweh never left mankind. He sent forth his angels. Many, many, numerous angels in their billions. Yes, angels of Yahweh in their billions, watching over the earth, watching over the children of Yahweh. That's why Yahweh says, Jacob, I am with you wherever you go. Do you think that statement was just made by mouth or by just mere saying? No. He followed it up with action, with his angels around you. Do you know, open for me, Psalm chapter 34. Listen to what Yahweh says. Psalm chapter 34. He said he encamped his angels round about those that fear him. Isn't it? Psalm chapter 34. Read for me. Just start reading from verse 1. That is a marvelous promise. It's for the saints. Psalm 34 is for the saints. Read it.
I will bless Yahweh at all times. Mm-hmm. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Mm-hmm. My soul shall make her boast in Yahweh. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify Yahweh with me, and let us exalt his name together. Mm-hmm. I sought Yahweh, and he heard me, and delivered me from all my fears. Mm-hmm. They looked unto him, and were enlightened, and their face were not ashamed. Mm-hmm. This poor man cried, and Yahweh heard him, and saved him out of his troubles. The angel of Yahweh encampeth around about them that fear him.
Did you hear that?
And delivered them.
Read it again.
Verse 7. The angel of Yahweh encampeth around about them that fear him and delivered them.
Okay, don't worry, because we have so much to deal with. The angel of Yahweh. Yahweh will never leave you or forsake you. In as much as you are obedient to him, in as much as you keep to his way, in as much as you remain within the covenant that he gave to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that Yahshua is the mediator today, in as much as you keep on with that covenant, Yahweh will never leave you. Yahweh will never forsake you. Yahweh will always watch over you and keep you wherever you go. His angels will encamp over you or around you. And that's why most times we say we see miracle. Miracles suddenly, this intervention come from nowhere. Because there are angels that are around, you don't see them. Yahweh made it in such a way that you don't see them. Otherwise, you worship them. If you see the angels, you worship them. Yahweh try to avoid anything. Doesn't want your heart to be corrupted. Because human beings is very weak to the point that any slightest personality or spirit or whatever that comes close to him and he sees that is a power, the individual will be ready to bow to that either angel or that power. So Yahweh ensure that we don't see them, but they see us. Except in exceptional situation, Yahweh will open your eyes to see them. When he want to minister or send some certain message to you, that's the way he want to, like in the days of old, the fathers of old, most of them spoke to angels. So it does happen that way. So do not be afraid. As you are in this journey, you are blessed. You are a child of Yahweh. You are a chosen of Yahweh. You see, all he need is faith. Have faith in him. Have faith in Yahshua. Follow him with that absolute faith. Whatever you open your mouth to say will come to pass, because you are issuing a decree. You are a lawgiver. You give law. Whatever you speak with your mouth is law, because you are son of a lawgiver. So you are law by yourself. The world will obey you. Whatever around you must obey you. Because that is how it's supposed to be. You are a son to your father, who owns everything and commands everything. Everything is under his control. So here, we establish that Israel is the choice of Yahweh. Israel is the select of Yahweh. Israel is the elect of Yahweh. Israel is the heartbeat, so to speak, amongst all humans. Of Yahweh can never joke or toil. Look at how Israel dribbled Yahweh. Look at how Israel played Yahweh. Look at how Israel has been messing up here and there. But Yahweh so loved Israel. He said, Israel, do not make nonsense of your call. Don't boast because you are many. He said, of all nations of the world, you are the smallest. But I have chosen you. And Yahweh said, I have chosen you and made you to be the greatest of all. Unfortunately, Israel were to be the head. Suddenly, because of how they have been playing their life, they have brought themselves to be the tail. Deuteronomy chapter 28. They brought themselves to be tail instead of head. But Sunday, Yahweh is working things out. Sunday, as Israel continue in the way that Yahweh has called them, the little, the small number will be head and they will rule the earth. Remember, this is a promise to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. A promise even to Yahshua, that through Yahshua, they will rule the entire world. To the east, to the west, to the north, to the south. Until the entire earth that was stolen by Satan will be recovered by Yahshua and all the brethren that will walk with him. And he will repossess and take over the earth as it were. Galatians chapter 3, 16 to 19. Now we look at number two question. Who is the seed promised by Yahweh? So we are still on question number one. But here we are looking at who is the seed promised by Yahweh. That seed, we'll be mentioning that seed. Who is it? Let's Bible confirm this seed. Because Bible, you know, interprets itself. Galatians chapter 3, 16 to 19. Galatians 3, 16 to 19. Now to Abraham and his seed, singular, were the promises made. What are you inferencing here? What are you reading from this? What we are reading here is that Abraham and his seed, Yahweh made promises to, not to another, not to the people from east or west or north or south, not from others from the world, not from nations of the world, but from Abraham and his seed only. He does not say, and to seeds as of many, but as of one. Looking at one, out of many that Abraham bear as children, one out of them, one is the seed that Yahweh is looking at, that is going to do the work of salvation, perform the work of salvation. But as of one, and to your seed, who is Messiah. And this I say, that the law, which was 430 years later, cannot annul the covenant that was confirmed before by Yahweh in Messiah, that it should make the promise of no effect. Now, Apostle Paul, writing here, says that seed is one singular seed. And the law given cannot annul the promise that was made. That promise that was made with Abraham. Remember Genesis we read, chapter 12 and chapter 17. That was where the promise was made, that a seed will be given. Now, the promise that was made is stronger than whatever law that comes later, 430 years later. Now, what is the law he's talking about? There is a law. He's not talking about the covenant. He's talking about a law. There's a particular law that came in between or later. That law will never nullify the promise. Now, the promise is that a seed will come and a seed will bring salvation to Israel. As a result, the law that was given, the law of sacrifice, don't think that law of sacrifice will become grace. And therefore, you enter the kingdom. That is a temporary something that is going to help you because you're a sinner. Your heart is so seared and so, you know, obliterated in sin that you have lost your identity. But with the Son and the Spirit of the Son, your heart is going to be corrected. Okay. Everything that is lost in you will be brought back, and you will find yourself back to the Father that called you, and you'll be part of the kingdom because you will now gain salvation as a result. Now he says, and this I say, that the law, which was 430 years later, cannot annul the covenant that was confirmed before by Yahweh in Messiah, that it should make the promise of no effect. For if the inheritance is of the law, it is no longer of promise, but Yahweh gave it to Abraham by promise. See what happened. When Israel came back from Egypt, even in the wilderness, they will continue to sin, to sin, to sin. Yahweh said, okay, what I will do now is to give them a law, a particular law, not the Torah, not the covenant law, but a law that was added, because this law came later after the covenant. He added it. That's law of sacrifice. That is the last law. That law of sacrifice came as a temporary holding to help Israel to, you know, when they sin, that was the provision that Yahweh made. Instead of Yahweh cutting them off or destroying them. So when you sin, you take a lamb or a bird and you kill it, the blood will atone for your sin. What they were doing, or what Yahweh asked them to do, is take this animal as a something that will, you know, cover for you, or will stand for your debt, so that you don't die. And this is an emergency. It's a temporary something. It will be a cover until the one who the promise was, you know, pointing to or was made will come to you. That one is the Messiah, Yeshua. So that law, the law of sacrifice, was a temporary something. The priestly law, the law of the priests or priesthood, that brought about also the sacrificial law, will stand temporarily. And when Yeshua came, that law disappeared. And that's where the Christians look at and say, ah, the law, which law? You have to know the law you're talking about. Are you talking about Torah, the word of Yahweh? How can you say the word of Yahweh is canceled? You can't. The law that was added, the law of sacrifice, is what must go. So, here is the purpose or the goal of the law. Verse 19 reads, what purpose then does the law serve? Which law? Law of sacrifice. It was added because of transgressions. Did you hear that? This law was added because of the sin, transgression, breaking of the law, the covenant of Yahweh, breaking of that law was the reason, so that it will be used to atone for the sins of Israel until he that was appointed, he that was reckoned to do what? To save Israel will come. Let's take that again. What purpose then does the law serve? It was added because of transgressions, till the seed, that is Yeshua Messiah, should come to whom the promise was made, and it was appointed through angels by the hand of a mediator. Now, take this note. I want to repeat it so that you understand that particular verse properly. The law here refers to the law of sacrifice. It was introduced temporarily to cover the sins of Israel till the appointed seed, that is Yeshua Messiah, in whom the purpose of the goal of the law arrives. When Yeshua came, he assumed the mediator of the law, that is the new covenant. Everybody that must be saved shall come under this covenant.
to obey the law of Yahweh forever. This is the mandate that everybody must partake. You must be part of the covenant. You must be part of keeping the law of the covenant in order for you to be saved, in order for you to inherit the kingdom. So, in a nutshell, let's summarize that question. One, who is the elect? Thus, Yahshua is that seed that was promised to Abraham, upon which Israel and the entire nations of the earth shall be blessed. So the question, who is the elect, has answer in Israel. Israel is the elect. The elect is not the Gentile Christians. The elect is not the Gentile or the hidden nations of the world. But through the acts of the seed from Israel, the olive tree, according to Romans chapter 11, verse 24, shall the rest of the world be saved and be blessed. Israel is called the olive tree, whose head or leader or king is Yahshua Messiah. He is the fulfillment of the promise to Abraham, whose seed shall inherit the land. He is the fulfillment of the Savior, who will save Israel from their sins and the rest of humanity, and make the entire earth a righteous place to dwell. The basis upon which anyone shall inherit the land or the kingdom is by entering into the covenant Yahweh made with Abraham, and now overseas by Yahshua Messiah as the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon the better promise or promises, as was enshrined in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 6. This is called the new covenant. This means that all Israelites exist by virtue of keeping the covenant and are called covenant keepers. Every Israelite is a covenant keeper. Believers or followers of Yahshua Messiah are also called the Nazarenes, or the covenant keepers. To inherit the land or the kingdom as promised to Abraham, every son or daughter of Israel must follow the truth and the way. That is the covenant way, which Yahshua testifies. Yahshua says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. We cannot go to the Father. We cannot even enter the land where the Father is the governor general, the owner. We can't enter there without taking to the covenant way. You must partake. You must belong. Yahshua is the way. You must follow that way. Yahshua is the truth. You must take to that truth of Yahshua. And Yahshua is the life giver who will bring us into that land. Now, that is in John chapter 14, verse 6, and Acts chapter 4, verses 10 and 12. He is the way, the truth, and the life. The commonwealth of all true believers is called Israel, the olive tree. It's Israel first, then the Gentiles. Israel first, then the Gentiles. Is the Gentiles cut off? No. Their own time is coming. But the chosen, the elect, is Israel. And Yahweh is working. Yahweh wants to redeem the earth. Mankind, he began that through a particular people, and that is Israel, the choice. So when people, when somebody as a Christian will come and tell you, we are the selected breeds, we are the, you know, those that have been prepared to possess the kingdom. Now they are talking about heaven. We are the people that have been prepared to be raptured into heaven. Now you ask them, which Bible are you using? Ask them, which Bible are you using? Because if Israel says they are if the Christians or any other religion says they are the chosen of Yahweh,
the chasing of the father. He asked them, which book are they using? Because the Bible, which is the holy book, the book that was given by Yahweh, which is Torah, which Moses delivered to Israel, that book never gave us a different opinion. It was just from Genesis to Exodus, then to Revelation. That book has stated that Israel is the choice of Yahweh, the beloved of Yahweh. And there's no two ways about it. So if anybody want to, that is shifting your mind to something else, which is ruinous, which is dangerous, which is murderous, which may lead to destruction at the end of the day. Because the name is Israel, and when Yahshua returns, that name is the name that is going to be used. When Yahweh changed the name of Jacob to Israel, he didn't just change it as a name of a person. He had in mind that name is going to be the nation that he promised Abraham. So that identity, that name that bears Israel, is never lost and will never be lost at all. Because if anybody will tell you, I have a different version of, you know, what salvation is all about and where I'm going, then if the person doesn't bring in Israel and tell you how everybody will be brought in, whether you are an Israelite born of Abraham or you are a Gentile, if you do not bear that, you know, that lineage, or go to that lineage, or be grafted into that lineage of olive tree, which is Israel, then the person is out of Yahweh's commonwealth of Israel. The person is completely out. So we are called believers. When you hear believers is not in any other religion. Well, they can be believers in whatever they believe, but we are believers that are found in Yahshua Messiah. We are believers that follow the way, the covenant way, the olive tree, which is Israel. They are believers. True Israelites are covenant keepers. It's Israel first, then the Gentiles. All Gentiles shall be saved by receiving the Messiah of Israel, Yahshua. That is how Yahweh has put it. Some of the scriptures' confirmation of Israel as elect are numerous. Amos chapter 3, 1 to 3. Junior, help me. Some of us will read it for me. Amos chapter 3, 1 to 3. Isaiah 41. Terry, can you help me read Amos chapter 3, 1 to 3? Amos chapter 3, 1 to 3. Or 1 to 2. Just make it 1 to 2.
I can't find it.
Junior, help me. Isaiah 41, 8 to 9. Isaiah 41, 8 to 9. Bright, if you are hearing me, Isaiah 41, 1 to 2. Isaiah 41, 1 to 2. AD, if you are there, help me read Isaiah 45, verse 4. Can we start with Junior?
Isaiah 41, 8 to
9.
Mm-hmm. I will open rivers in high places and mm-hmm. fountain in midst of the valleys. I will make the wilderness a pool of water mm-hmm. and the dry land springs of water.
Mm-hmm.
I will plant in the wilderness the cedar, the shittah tree, and the myrtle and the oil tree. I will set in the desert the fig tree and the pine and the box tree together.
Is it Isaiah 41 you are reading?
18 to 19.
No, 8 to 9.
Oh, 8 to 9. But thou, Israel, art my servant Jacob,
mm-hmm.
whom I have chosen,
mm-hmm.
the seed of Abraham, my mm-hmm. friend.
Mm-hmm.
Thou, whom I have taken from the ends of the earth
mm-hmm.
and called thee from the chief men, thereof, and said unto thee, Thou art my servant, I have chosen thee, and not cast thee away.
Have you seen it? You can see chosen there. From descendants of Abraham, he is chosen. He was taken from the ends of the earth. He was taken. He was called. Look at those words that we are there. That shows you that he is, Israel is the choice of Yahweh. Israel is the called of Yahweh. That confirms that. Another scripture, Terry, can you help me read Amos 3 verse 1 to 2?
Hear this words that Yahweh have spoken against you, O children of Israel, against the whole family which I brought up from the land of Egypt, saying, You have I known of all the families of the earth, therefore I will punish you for all your iniquities.
Hallelujah! Of all the families of the earth, you Israel, I have chosen. I called you. And he, as you continue in your sin, I'm going to punish you. You see, when Yahweh is dealing with Israel, when they misbehave, he told David, your children, your descendants, when they misbehave, I will use a rod against them. I will cane them. I will flog them. I will punish them. So that is what we see. Today, Israel is receiving punishment because they never heeded the covenant that was given to them. So Yahweh scattered them all over the world. Up to today, Israel is still receiving their punishment. And in the latter days, Yahweh will come for them. And we are already in the latter days. So are you getting prepared? Who else? Read for me. Isaiah 44. Eddie and Bright.
Isaiah
44, 1 to 2, or Isaiah 45 and 4. Anyone you can read there.
Okay.
Isaiah 44, 1 to 2.
Isaiah 44, 1 to 2. I read. Yet now hear, O Jacob, my servant, and Israel, whom I have chosen. So said Yahweh, that made thee and formed thee from the womb, which will help thee. Fear not, O Jacob, my servant, and thou, Israel, whom I have chosen.
He has called him, he has chosen him. That word rang bell again. Isaiah 45, verse 4. AD, are you there?
Isaiah 45, verse 4.
Yes.
For Jacob said, and Israel by the bed, I have even called thee by thy name. I have chosen thee, though I have not known thee.
Hallelujah. Jacob, my servant's sake, and Israel, my elect. Did you hear that? I have even called you by your name. I have named you, though you have not known me. Did you hear that? Is it true or false? In Genesis, he called Jacob. Jacob, your name shall no longer be Jacob. Your name shall be what? Israel. And Isaiah is accurate here. Say, Jacob, my servant's sake, and Israel, my elect, I have even called you by your name. He called him by his name. The name that is called Israel today, it was given by Yahweh to Jacob. And that is what Israel. Israel as a people, Israel as a nation, Israel as elect. That is what they are. Nothing more, nothing less. They are the chosen, they are the people of Yahweh. Now let us hear... Here, Apostle Paul, Romans chapter 6, 3 to 6. Apostle Paul, you know, says something in Romans chapter 6, 3 to 6. Or do you not know that as many of us as we are baptized into Yahshua Messiah, we are baptized into his death, therefore we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Messiah was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so, we also should walk in newness of life. All Israelites are called to walk in the newness of life. Who brought the newness of life? Yahshua, via his Holy Spirit. That is how you obtain newness of life. Your old person, your old man are buried, are gone. Once you baptize in the name of Yeshua, you come to that newness of life. The Holy Spirit will take over. The Holy Spirit will be speaking. The Holy Spirit will be, you know, helping us to do what? To continue in the newness of life. Verse 4. Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Messiah was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk the newness of life. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. Hallelujah. On and on and on, we have massive Bible passages that declare who we are, how we are elected as Israelites. Hosea chapter 11 verse 1, Jeremiah 31 verse 9, Deuteronomy 7, 6 to 8, Deuteronomy 14 verse 2, Deuteronomy 26, 17 to 19, 2 Samuel 7, 23 to 24, 1 Kings 8, 52, 1 Chronicles 17, 20 to 21, Psalms 105, 5 to 15, Psalm 135 verse 4. Let us look at Psalm 135 verse 4. Psalm 35 verse 4. Psalm 135 verse 4. Psalm 135 verse 4. It reads, for there is not a word on my tongue, but behold, sorry, that's a different portion I was reading. For Yahweh has chosen Jacob for himself, Israel for his special treasure. Israel for his special treasure. And if you go to Psalm 105, which we read a while ago, it was saying the same thing, 105, 8 to 15. Psalm 135, verse 4, which I said, Isaiah 43, 1 to 3, Isaiah 44, 21, Jeremiah 31, 1 to 4, Jeremiah 31, 9 to 11, Jeremiah 46, 27 to 28, Ezekiel 36, 24 to 28, Ezekiel 37, 21 to 25, Joel 3, 1 to 2, Hebrews 8, 8 to 13, Romans 6, 3 to 6. I have just tried to read them to assure us that we are not just speaking from our head. We are not just speaking from our own mindset or our own making. But Bible has to confirm what we've been saying since, that Israel are the elect, Israel are the chosen, Israel are the first, Israel, we are picked among the nations to be those that will join hands with Yeshua to deliver the world. Now, the second aspect of this message says, who and how is the elect called? Who and how is the elect called? Now, let's look at the passages. Let them also interpret and explain to us what the query is all about. John chapter 6 verse 37, we read, all that the Father gives me, Yeshua said, will come to me, and the one who comes to me, I will by no means cast out. What does that mean? Now, the Father gives, this is how it goes, the Father will call us, and he does what? He gives us to Yeshua. Did you get that statement? All that the Father gives me. So it's the Father that brings us. The Father calls us. The Father selects. The Father says, okay, this one, take care of him. What does Yeshua do? We are going to see in a while what he does to those who are called by the Father, whom the Father gives to him. Now, John chapter 6 verse 14, he said, no one can come to me, that is Yeshua, unless the Father who sent me draws or calls him, and I will raise him up at the last day. He must be walking with the individual that the Father gives to him, prepare the individual, make sure that his spirit is with the person and the spirit works with the person. The spirit refines our heart. The second baptism takes place. The second circumcision takes place in the heart. So he does that and gets the person prepared that when he returns, at the sound of the trumpet, he will call the person. It's only those that the Father gives to him and he prepared will respond to the call when the trumpet will sound. Only those, not all that walks into assembly or what you call church today, not only those that walk in there and claim that they are children of Yahweh. You must discover whether the Father called you. You can be in the church as you like or the assembly as you like, but if you are not called by Yahweh, or if you have not discovered that you are called and walk towards the call, you may be walking in vain all your life. It must be the Father that called you. This is vital. Get it into your mind. This is the truth of the scripture we are, you know, reading or have been discussing since. It's very, very important you know whether you are called or not. How do you know? The confirmation is in Yeshua, who gives you his spirit. So if the virtues, if the fruits of the spirit is not manifesting in you, then you ask yourself, am I called? Then if that fruit is not there, you shall know quickly that you are not called. And you do something about it. You go back to the Father. You go to the Father and begin to ask him. Begin to, you know, pray to him. Begin to request. Begin to beg him to admit you into his family. That is how it is done. John chapter 6 verse 65. And he said, therefore I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it has been granted to him by my Father. It is the Father that grants, that calls, that if the Father says no, somebody may walk into the assembly. He may be there. He may be a tithe giver. He may be an offering giver. He may be a pleasant fellow. But Yahweh has not chosen him. Was Esau not born in the house of Jacob? Where is Esau today? He said, Esau and Jacob, I know the two, I bring the two, but Jacob I have chosen, not Esau. Why? Because there is something in Esau that Yahweh doesn't tolerate. Esau is like Cain. He never chose that Cain that slaughtered his brother. Yahweh, of the two brothers, Abel and Cain, Yahweh chose Abel. In a family, we must be very careful. There are some that are chosen, there are some that are not chosen. And in some family of Israel, Yahweh may decide to choose all of them. Depends on your, you know, disposition to Yahweh. Depends on how you agree with Yahweh. Depends on how you are listening to his word. If you cue in and begin to listen to Yahweh and do what he calls you to do, he will choose you. Because all he's looking for is those who will worship him in spirit and in truth. And in obedience to his word, you must be obedient to his word. Now, let us take notes. Who calls the elect or the chosen? Who? The elect or the chosen is called by the Father, Yahweh. The Father gives the elect to the Son, Yeshua, for cleansing of sins and preparation for salvation and the inheritance of the eternal kingdom. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 15. An individual at receiving Yeshua repents of sins and gets baptized into Yeshua's name. This is important. If Yahweh calls you and brings you into the family, the next thing you do is to do what? Baptize into Yeshua Messiah. You receive him, you baptize into his name. If you have not baptized into his name, you may be walking in vain. Because it's a command. You cannot destroy it. You cannot remove it. You cannot wish it away. You must take that command on board and apply yourself to it. you must baptize in the name of Yeshua. Yeshua in turn gives the repented and baptized person his gift of the Holy Spirit, which in turn provides fruits that empowers the individual to continue to obey the Father's words or commandments. Thus, Israel remains the only called of Yahweh and the called and the chosen that must have faith in Yeshua. The just shall live by faith in Yeshua Messiah after he or she has been baptized into the name of Yeshua. The following Bible verses or chapters can help. The elect or call of the brethren, you can see that in Deuteronomy 7 verse 6. Junior, quickly. I pray we get to the third question, then we close. Because it's quite massive. It's going to take us to this. Deuteronomy chapter 7 to 6. How many? Verse 6. Deuteronomy chapter 7 verse 6. Exodus 19. 4 to 6. Brother Edward, please help us read Exodus 19, 4 to 6. Junior, read.
Deuteronomy 7, 6.
Mm-hmm.
For thou art an holy people unto Yahweh thy Father.
Mm-hmm.
Yahweh thy Father hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself, above all people that are upon the face of the earth.
Hallelujah. Upon all the whole human beings in this surface of the earth, Yahweh chose Israel to be his people. Did you hear that? That is clear. He didn't say Yahweh chose the Gentile. He didn't say Yahweh chose the nations. He didn't say Yahweh chose the population of the earth. No. At least not now. You say, what about the Gentiles? Don't worry about the Gentiles. Gentiles will be saved. If they want to be saved, they'll be saved. So that is not our headache at the moment. Yahweh is working things out. Exodus 19. 46. Yes, help us read, please, Brother Edward.
Exodus
19, 46.
Yeah. Ye have sent me, how I have brought you unto my people. Now, therefore, ye will obey my voice indeed and keep my commandment, and ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me about the whole people. For all the earth is mine. 6. And ye shall be a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The criteria for you to qualify is obey the voice of Yahweh, keep his covenant, then you will be what? Special treasure. Above all people, above all human beings in the surface of the earth. And you shall be to Yahweh a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. This is how Israel is holy. This is how Israel is, because they are covenant keepers. They must keep the covenant and they must obey the voice of Yahweh to do it. Exodus, Psalm 135 verse 4, Isaiah 41, 8 to 9, Matthew 10, 1 to 5, Galatians 2 verse 20, Habakkuk 2 verse 4, Romans 1, 17, Galatians 3, 11, Hebrews 10 verse 38. Quickly, and we'll be rounding off from here. How will the elect receive salvation? Question 3. How will the elect receive salvation? Number 1. Have faith in Yeshua. Number 2. Constantly eat and drink the word of Yahweh. 3. Constantly eat and eat the flesh and drink the blood of Yeshua. That is, you must be a participant or partaker of the Passover meal. After being baptized into his name, you can't take the Passover meal when you have not baptized in the name of Yeshua. So after being baptized, you begin to take the meal as prescribed from the scriptures. Number 4, hear his word. You must be here. You must be hearing his word, as we read in Exodus there a while ago. Do his will. Do his word. keep the covenant. Number 5, follow Yahshua Messiah every day till he returns. That is the way to do what? To receive the salvation that is given to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, all the elect Israelites. John chapter 5 verse 24. John chapter 5 verse 24. Do you know, read for me. John chapter 5, 39 to 40. While I take John chapter 5, verse 24. John 5, 24. Most assuredly I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life. It's only those that hear his word. It's only those that obey his word. It's only that those that have faith in him that will have everlasting life. And shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life. As we continue to follow him and keep to the covenant commandment, follow Yahshua, we will not be judged again. We are passing through our judgment every day. He's judging us every day. If we are obedient, if we are doing what he asks us to do, we will not enter into judgment or condemnation tomorrow. Go on, read for me chapter 5.
John 5, verse
39 to 40.
John 5, 39. Search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. And ye will not come to me that ye might have life.
You see why they will miss life? Why they will miss everlasting life? They search the scriptures, yet they are not coming to him. They are searching the scriptures. He called them, come to me. They refuse. Because the scripture they are searching is him. But yet, they don't internalize what they are reading in their heart and begin to do. And that's why we talk about doing, doing. Yahshua said, you must do. You must do and you must teach. That's how you become part of him. Go on.
41. I receive not honor from men, but I know you that ye have not the love of the Father in you.
That's all right. They don't have the love of the Father. How do you get the love of the Father? How do you have that love? You can only have the love of the Father when what the Father says, the word of the Father enters into your ear, you begin to do. You love to do it. Do it. Apply yourself to it. Once you shrug yourself, once you begin to pick the ones you do and the ones you wouldn't do, that doesn't show love. Yahweh wants totality. What he says to you, do, do. What he says don't do, don't do. That is how we, you know, love him. Because his word is what, you know, binds us. Is what brings our relationship with him together. That's what ties us, his word. John chapter 14, verse 15. Luke 6, 46. Malachi chapter 1, verse 6. Matthew 7, 21. Now, this is where we'll be stopping, but I have to summarize it. We'll stop here. It goes with question. Next week, we continue from here as part two of this. It has gone into part two. Did Yahweh elect only Israel? I mean, somebody may be waiting to ask this question. I've been talking about Israel, Israel, Israel. Is it only Israel? Did Yahweh choose of all the entire... Yahweh says, of all nations of the earth, Israel, you have I chosen. So, is Yahweh saying the whole other human beings, they'll be wiped out? It's only Israel. What did the Bible say concerning others? Next week, we're going to look at it. The Bible clearly declares that Israel is the only nation Yahweh called or chose for himself. And through them, the entire world will be blessed. Genesis chapter 12, verse 3. We read it a while ago. Exodus 19, 5 to 6. Amos 3, verse 2. And 1 Peter 2, 5 and 9. Israel are peculiar. Israel are holy. Israel are chosen nation. The Old Testament focuses on Yahweh's relationship with the Hebrews, the people of Israel. Throughout the scriptures, Yahweh did not mince words by telling us that the Israelites were his chosen special or peculiar people. Exodus 19, 5 to 6, Deuteronomy 7, 6, and so on and so forth. But what about the other purpose of the earth? Did Yahweh have any plans for those who had not received his special election and care? Did Yahweh simply decide to harden their hearts in order to punish them? Or did Yahweh call any of them to himself to bring eternal salvation to them? And now that the Messiah has come, can those who are unreached or that have not been touched with the word of Yahweh, with the gospel of Yahshua Messiah, can they be saved? These are difficult questions to answer when it comes to the Gentiles and those in religions of the world today, for instance, Judaism, Christianity, Islam, etc. These people have not agreed on the answers in this question. Did Yahweh elect only Israel? These people, these others in different religions, called the Gentiles, they have their own opinion. They have different mindset to the call and where they have their heart, where they have their belief and whom they believe. So next week, by his special grace, we'll continue from did Yahweh elect only Israel? Because it's broad. We'll answer that, you know, vis-a-vis what we have been saying since. What you have to take in what we have been discussing is that Israel is the special elect of Yahweh. And the eyes of Yahweh is on you who has been elected. Have you responded to Yahweh's call? Yahweh choose you. Have you responded? Or are you still shaking your head and struggling to meet the call? Or are you being forced? Are you being reminded of your call every day, every week, every month? Are you doing it as you want, as you will? Oh, when I want, when I will, when I wake up, when it suits me, I will follow them. You will miss the kingdom. Because Yahweh will not pursue you forever. Yahweh will not call you forever. Yahweh will not wait for you forever. There are those that Yahweh called. He sent them. And midway, they said, I will not continue. There are those he called. They outright they rejected his call. There are those he called, almost reaching to grab the salvation. They let go and it went back into the world. Where are you? Are you going, moving forcefully without looking back? Because he said, he that lays hand in the plow should not look back. And he said, if you look back, if you stop, said his spirit will not be in you to help you to continue. Because once you leave the way, the covenant way, the Holy Spirit will leave you. Then you will not continue the journey. So think of what Yahweh has instructed us to do. That we are the called, we are the chosen. And because you are the called, Yahweh's eyes is on you. Yahweh is helping you, keeping you wherever you are. Don't be afraid for whatever that is fighting you, whatever that is around you. When the trouble is on you or is overwhelming, all you need to do is to lift up your hand and call upon him. He will quickly secure you. He will quickly, because he said, I will keep you. I will protect you. I will defend you. I will help you. Whether it's sickness, he said, I'm your healer. Whether it is food that you have to eat, he said, I'm your provider. Yahweh is your shelter. He said, his name is a strong tower. He said, my name. No, do you know my name? My name is the strong tower that is your covering. Because his name is upon your forehead. Do you know? You are carrying his name. You are living by his name. And you run into that his name, you are covered, you are protected, you are sheltered. Whatever attack will backfire upon the enemy. That is the promise of Yahweh to you. Why would you look back? Why would you be thinking, is Yahweh following me? Yahweh is asking you, move on. He is with you 24 hours. May Yahweh keep you. May Yahweh strengthen you. May Yahweh fortify you. May Abba Yahweh keep and bless you and strengthen you as an Israelite. May he keep you as you continue. And all those that join Israel, may Yahweh keep them up to the time that Yahshua will return for us all to inherit the kingdom. May Yah protect and keep you. May your obedience never diminish. May your love for him never be taken away. May your brethren who hears your voice follow you and do the will of your master, Yahshua Messiah, that follows. May Abba Yahweh continue to teach us and to bless us, to bless our hearts to the end, until we see him in glory. Thank you, Father, for hearing us. In Yeshua's name we pray.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.